Welcome to our online worship services for Maundy, Thursday. Maundy, Thursday is the first in a series of special services which stand quite apart from the rest of the church calendar. The Triduum, these services, Maundy, Thursday, Good Friday, and the Easter Vigil, have a different flow, and in fact, are liturgically intended to be stitched all together as one. But that's not the way that we typically experience them in our modern schedule and the way that church services ebb and flow. And particularly in this year, things are a little different as we are not permitted to gather together in person to worship. But let me still begin with the words of instruction that have been used for more than a generation, iterations of it going back far before that. In this Lenten season, we have heard our Lord's call to intensify our struggle against sin, death, and the devil, all that keeps us from loving God and each other. This is the struggle to which we were committed at baptism. God's forgiveness and the power of His Spirit to amend our lives continue with us because of His love for us in Jesus, our Savior. Within the community of His church, God never wearies of giving peace and new life. In the words of absolution, we receive forgiveness as from God Himself. This absolution we should not doubt, but firmly believe that thereby our sins are forgiven before God in heaven, for it comes to us in the name and by the command of our Lord. We who receive God's love in Jesus Christ are called to love one another, to be servants to each other as Jesus became our servant. Our commitment to this loving service is signified sometimes in the washing of feet, following the example the Lord gave us on the night before His death, as recorded in John's Gospel. It is, however, in the Holy Communion that the members of Christ's body participate most intimately in His love. Remembering our Lord's Last Supper with His disciples, we eat the bread and share the cup of this meal. Today we receive the Lord's gift of Himself and participate in that new covenant which makes us one in Him. The Eucharist is the promise of the great banquet we will share with all the faithful when our Lord returns, the culmination of our reconciliation with God and each other. And so this evening, we will not physically gather. We will not participate in that intimate celebration of the Lord's Supper. We will not wash the feet of one another. We will not have that closeness, that fellowship, which is the primary character of this service. But nonetheless, we know that we are united with all Christians around the world, that God has knit us together in one beautiful and mystical church, even when we cannot be physically together, physically present in the same building. And so, let us prepare our hearts for worship. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a troubled and penitent sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities with which I have offended you, and for which I justly deserve your punishment. But I am sorry for them, and repent of them, and pray for your boundless mercy. For the sake of the suffering and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Forgive my sins. Give me your Holy Spirit for the amendment of my sinful life, and bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His Son to die for us, and for His sake forgives us all our sins. Through His Holy Spirit, He cleanses us and gives us power to proclaim the mighty deeds of God, who called us out of darkness into the splendor of His light. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by His authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In obedience to the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. Amen. Our liturgy continues now with the prayer of the day. Let us pray. Holy God, your Son gave us a new commandment, and through His act of radical servanthood, He showed us the way of true love. Grant that we may share his servant nature as we live out your reign, awaiting the promise of his return. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading is from the 24th chapter of Exodus. When Moses went and told the people all the Lord's words and laws, they responded with one voice, "Everything the Lord has said, we will do." Moses then wrote down everything the Lord had said. He got up early the next morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain and set up 12 stone pillars representing the 12 tribes of Israel. Then he sent young Israelite men, and they offered burnt offerings and sacrificed young bulls as fellowship offerings to the Lord. Moses took half of the blood and put it in bowls, and the other half he sprinkled on the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it to the people. They responded, "We will do everything the Lord has said. We will obey." Moses then took the blood, sprinkled it on the people, and said, "This is the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and the 70 elders of Israel went up and saw the God of Israel. Under his feet was something like a pavement made of sapphire, clear as the sky itself. But God did not raise his hand against these leaders of the Israelites. They saw God, and they ate and drank. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading is from the 9th chapter of Hebrews, beginning at the 11th verse. When Moses went and told the people all the Lord's words and laws, they responded with one voice, "Everything the Lord has said, we will do." Moses then wrote down everything the Lord had said. He got up early the next morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain and set up 12 stone pillars representing the 12 tribes of Israel. Then he sent young Israelite men, and they offered burnt offerings and sacrificed young bulls as fellowship offerings to the Lord. Moses took half of the blood and put it in bowls, and the other half he sprinkled on the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it to the people. They responded, "We will do everything the Lord has said, and we will obey." Moses then took the blood, sprinkled it on the people, and said, "This is the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and the 70 elders of Israel went up and saw the God of Israel. Under his feet was something like a pavement made of sapphire, clear as the sky itself. But God did not raise his hands against these leaders of the Israelites. They saw God, and they ate and drank. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So you've just heard here basically the same words twice, but we note that it's important to be reminded of them in the sense that the first version was from the Old Testament, and the New Testament in the book of Hebrews was reminding people of precisely that first covenant so that they could then understand the new covenant in Christ. The gospel is written in the 26th chapter of Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Where do you want us to make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" He replied, "Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says, my appointed time is near. I'm going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.' So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, 'I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me.' They were very sad and began to say to him one after the other, 'Surely not I, Lord.' Jesus replied, 'The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born. Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." Jesus answered, "Yes, it is you." While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. It's sad to be sort of gathered, and we are truly gathered on a certain level, but to be sort of gathered on Maundy, Thursday, and not be anticipating sharing yet this evening Holy Communion together. And yet, it is a powerful time for reflection. What is this gift of the Lord's Supper? And why are we not sharing it across the internet? And is it impossible to do so? And if it is, why are some churches doing it and some churches not doing it? And all of those are good questions. They're not probably the questions at the top of our minds. The questions at the top of our minds will be how many thousands of our neighbors across this land and across this whole globe have died today as those statistics come to dominate the news cycles. The questions at the top of our mind may be, is my family safe? Are my loved ones that are far away from me safe? How long will this crisis go on? Those, reasonably, are the questions at the top of many people's minds. But if we pause, we think about these texts, we think about this day and its context as we near the end of Lent, it's reasonable to reflect for a bit on what is the Lord's Supper and why is it complicated and why do churches that are different understand it differently. And so let me just share a little bit of that without getting into too much of my first communion lecture for students or for seminarians. Let's just think about a few of the buzzwords. First of all, there's some long multisyllable words that enter the equation when we start talking about the Lord's Supper. All right, one that's not too many syllables, Eucharist, that's another word we use. And it just comes from the Greek, and it's the same thing. It is this holy supper that we share. But there are those big words. So one of the big words is transubstantiation. Transubstantiation is a description of the Roman Catholic understanding of Holy Communion, in which the body and blood, which are at first represented by a wafer and wine, are actually transformed into the body of Christ. That's the trans, and then the substance, substantiation, is changed. Now, you may have heard that Lutherans subscribe to consubstantiation, and that's sort of true. Don't you hate it in theology when you're told that something is sort of true? Well, we as Lutherans wouldn't typically claim that. That's normally language that others use to try to make sense of the many differences in understanding what exactly is happening in the Eucharist, the Lord's Supper. And so the notion of consubstantiation is that the bread and the wine, the little wafer and the small portion of wine, do not physically transform. All right, if you looked at them under a microscope as they were touching your tongue, you would still see molecules of the wheat that were used to make the little wafer, and you would still see molecules of wine as derived from the fermented grape juice. And yet, Christ is invisibly infused within those in the spirit of consubstantiation. But and that's a fairly close description to how Lutherans understand Holy Communion. But our description is much simpler, and it takes far fewer syllables, though others find it easier to use a similar phrase to transubstantiation to differentiate our view from that of Roman Catholics. Our understanding of Holy Communion, as we describe it, is simply real presence. And real presence means that we believe that Jesus Christ is present in the bread and the wine. The how, the why, none of that is necessary for us to understand. That's a part of the mystery of God that we are content to have explained to us in heaven. All that we need to know, all that we need to understand, all that we need to teach our children and each new generation is that when we receive the bread and wine of Holy Communion, Jesus Christ himself is present in the bread and the wine. That's it. We don't need a long multi-syllable word. We just believe in the real presence. But now there's another whole vast group within Christendom that are also free of long multi-syllable words. And those are the groups who celebrate Holy Communion without any layer of complexity about how exactly Christ is present, because they do not hold the real presence. So Roman Catholics and Lutherans, for example, have perhaps slightly different understandings of exactly how Christ is present, but both hold clearly to real presence. But there are many traditions in Christendom who do not have this, what we consider, a very high view of the sacraments. And so when they share Holy Communion, they are abiding by the Lord's instruction to do this in remembrance of me. So they are sharing the meal in remembrance of Jesus, but it is strictly in remembrance of Jesus. It does not have the same weight as a sacrament that it does, for example, for us. So, I'm lost in all this theory, Pastor. I got enough going on in my lives. Why the theology lecture? Well, it turns out to be a big deal when you're dealing with churches closed down for, you know, the first time in any of our lives for an extended period. And how it is that we then celebrate Holy Communion together. Because for a tradition that doesn't believe in real presence, that this is a sacrament that's being administered, this is just a nice reminder that Jesus loved us. Well, it's fairly easy for them to say, y'all get yourselves a little grape juice and a saltine cracker or something and set it on the table in front of you. Listen to our webcast. And when we say, all right, now eat the cracker, now drink the grape juice, that in their understanding that Holy Communion is merely remembering this beautiful thing that Jesus Christ did for us, that's easy enough to do despite the distance. And so some of those churches have adopted that plan for tonight. Now, it's also true that many of those same traditions, because they're not as driven by their sacramental understandings, it's not so big a deal to just push Holy Communion off for a little while. Some of these are traditions that only have Holy Communion maybe four times a year, maybe one time a year. And so not having it just on this one night isn't so big a deal for such traditions. But for Lutherans, it is a big deal, but it's also a thing that we hate to deprive people of when they are in a stressed environment looking to cling to their faith. So some pastors that I respect the pastoral concerns of have told people that they can commune over the internet tonight. They gave instructions to their congregation at their Palm Sunday telecast to get yourself some wine or grape juice, get yourself a little bit of bread or a cracker, and on Thursday night, when you watch our webcast, you'll have an opportunity to share Holy Communion. And I won't stand here and say that they're wrong. I'll just stand here and say that that's not normally how we understand Holy Communion. These clearly are not normal times. I felt a deep draw to the desire to offer that to our congregation. I prayed hard and consulted with friends and leaders about the notion of, you know, maybe we could do this as a drive-through. And there are churches who sorted out systems to actually do a drive-through delivery of the sacrament in full respect of safety protocols in this time of COVID-19. So it wasn't a haphazard institution of that plan, but opted not to do that at this time. There's a notion of fasting that we invite people to consider during the time of Lent. As Lutherans, we invite that as a personal practice, so we don't impose certain rules. We don't tell you that you cannot have protein from a mammal on Fridays in Lent, for example. We invite each person to, as a personal discipline, so not something that you make a big fuss about publicly, normally. You may just have to politely decline a piece of chocolate cake or whatever you chose to fast from. But we see the value of some form of fasting during Lent. And so there's a theological notion that one of the things that you can fast from is the bread and wine of Holy Communion. And so I'm inviting each of you, though that was not the thing, probably, that you started the season of Lent way back on Ash Wednesday, thinking that you might give up as part of your penitential practice during Lent. I'm inviting you for this time of national and global crisis to think of not partaking in the sacrament of Holy Communion as a form of fasting. That we are not so privately, not so secretly, but that we are, as a community, St. Paul's Lutheran Church, we together are fasting from the bread and wine of the Lord's Holy Meal. Now, does that mean that that has to be our answer forever? No, it does not. As you know, your leaders in this congregation continue to meet regularly using an electronic platform to do that so that we are fully compliant with the best guidance about social distancing. Even though we could get half of the church council in one meeting room, we're not doing anything like that. We're you know, if we have to have a couple people in the building at once, we keep spread out. when Pam is working at the church computer and I happen to be in the office at the same time, I speak to her from the door jamb. You know, we just keep good, healthy space between us at all times. But as your church leaders continue to meet during this crisis, we will continue to reassess. And there may come a time in 4 weeks where we say, we have fasted long enough that it is now burdensome upon us, and we need to find some mechanism for delivering Holy Communion. And we can do that in a crisis across an electronic medium. All right, it's not unheard of for a pastor to visiting a patient who is in isolation, extreme isolation, at a hospital, to have to pass the elements through or have the elements go through a system with the hospital to verify that they are safe, and then through an electronic speaker, speak the words of institution, or remind people of the words of the institution, as we typically do when we distribute the sacrament to members in their homes. So there are options down the road. But for now, I invite you to cling to this as a sense of fasting from the sacrament. But Maundy Thursday is an interesting day in the church year, as I said. And there are two principal things that we get biblically out of Maundy Thursday, and it depends which of the Gospels you're reading. For the Synoptics, the highlight of Maundy Thursday is the institution of the sacrament of Holy Communion. For John, you know, and we know John's words are just as true as all the other Gospel writers are, but John sometimes chose different conversations or different events that he thought were the most important to record for us, guided by the Holy Spirit, as were the Synoptic writers. And so for John, the big story, and you can find this in your Bibles at home, go to John chapter 13, verses 1 to 17, and you'll see a different, not sacramental, but a practice that can be carried out in remembrance. And you might consider that this evening. If you read through those verses, you'll see it describes foot washing. And in your household, you can wash one another's feet in the way that's described in that chapter. And that serves a different function for us than a sacrament, but in the sense that we are doing it in remembrance of Jesus' love for us, it does serve part of the function of the sacrament. A number of years ago, probably about 5 years ago, I was over in India, and we had gotten the first India district of the LCMC off the ground. And there was another large group of Lutherans that wanted to join with the India district. And they weren't getting along particularly well. And I was to come, and so they rented out a big community room in the city. And we gathered together for a day of teaching and prayer and preaching. And I had to figure out how we could get everyone to a starting point, because there was this jockeying for power between the two groups. And ultimately, the two groups did not come together, and I think that was God's will, and that was fine. But as we were reflecting on how we could possibly do this, I decided that foot washing was the best starting point. And because we didn't want to get into this one group versus the other, I just gave instructions to have several basins of water brought, and to have some volunteers that would keep replacing them, and a number of towels. And I just knelt down there on the concrete floor and washed the feet of over 200 pastors and church leaders as they came through. My first reflection was that that's hard on your knees if you're not used to doing that. But, you know, my deeper reflection was that that's a powerful symbol of the kind of humble service that Jesus was calling us to for each other. And so it's a useful practice, and I invite you to consider that in each of your households. Amen. Our tradition on Maundy Thursday, after we've heard God's word, after we have celebrated Holy Communion, after we have received absolution of our sins, is that we have the altar stripped while listening to Psalm 22 read, and then with the worship space somewhat darkened, we depart in silence. And so I will conclude our time together this evening with a reading of Psalm 22, at the close of which we will have eventually a black screen, and you will know that the service is concluded, and that because these services in Maundy Thursday and Good Friday are linked together, we don't end with a benediction. We simply, in silence, step back to contemplate the events that have happened and the events that we will contemplate afresh on Good Friday. Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me? From the words of my groaning. O my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our fathers trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delights in him. Yet you are he who took me from the womb. You made me trust at my mother's breasts. On you was I cast from my birth. And from my mother's womb you have been my God. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help me. Many bulls encompass me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me, like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death. For dogs encompass me. A company of evildoers encircles me. They have pierced my hands and feet. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far off. O you, my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion. You have rescued me from the horns of the wild oxen. I will tell of your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify him, and stand in awe of him, all you offspring of Israel. For he has not despised or abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, and he has not hidden his face from him, but has heard when he cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will perform before those who fear him. The afflicted shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before you. For kingship belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the prosperous of the earth eat and worship. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust, even the one who could not keep himself alive. Posterity shall serve him. It shall be told of the Lord to the coming generation. They shall come and proclaim his righteousness to a people yet unborn, that he has done it. Amen.